Hey, everybody. Today on the show, you're going to learn how you can become financially free while you're full-time in the military. So today's guest, Taylor Wing, managed to achieve this quite impressive fact by becoming completely financially free through real estate while he was also holding a full-time job in the military. And we're going to find out how he did it. So Taylor, welcome to the show.
Jonathan, thanks for having me. I'm super excited to be here with you guys today, share a little bit of my story, and hopefully add value to all of your listeners' lives a little bit.
Well, I'm sure you will, because I think there's a lot of people who are in a similar situation, whether they're, you know, not necessarily in the service, but they're in a full-time job, and they're wondering how it's possible to do this. I want to walk through, you know, exactly how you did it. But, you know, before we do that, just tell me a bit about your background, you know, other than real estate. So what is it that, you know, you've been doing with yourself up until now?
Yeah, so I'm still a younger guy. I graduated and commissioned out of the United States Military Academy in 2018, was spit out into the Army. And my main job was I was a field artillery officer, and I was stationed in Fort Bragg, North Carolina with the 82nd. And that's how I also got started in real estate while I was at that first duty station. Now, while I was at Fort Bragg, was doing the full time, I was a new lieutenant as a platoon leader, doing all the, you know, the airborne stuff. But I knew I wanted also to kind of help out my family and kind of pursue this journey of financial freedom. I mean, I listened to plenty of great podcasts just like this one and Bigger Pockets, and it kind of inspired me, you know, like, why can't I do this too? And so I spent about a year just contemplating what I was going to do with my life after the Army and who I was, what was my next step. And then kind of all the cards, all the chips kind of fell onto real estate. And so I just got really excited about real estate. And I'm one of those guys that when I latch onto something, I kind of get obsessed with it. And so I basically was like full-time Army and full-time real estate at the same time. There was nothing else that was really, my wife, my now wife, she was of course a big part of it. But she'll tell you though, I was pretty involved and I was working a lot, but basically came out of a situation where I was a new lieutenant, didn't have much savings, didn't have much money at all, but I was able to figure out ways through creative financing and through burr strategy to scale up to 32 doors in less than 2 years. Now, I don't come from a lot of money. I didn't have a lot of money saved up. So to me, I think the most interesting part of our story is that, you know, we did start with pretty much nothing. I saved up like 30 grand over my life, and I put all my life savings up to that point into real estate. And I was able to very quickly scale that into a portfolio we have now. Now we're sitting in a position with 32 doors. It kicks off roughly 15K in net passive income every month, which is enough for us to get by and allow me to step away from the military. And how I view it is we basically purchased our time back, because when I was full-time military, you know, deploying and going to all the training rotations, it was hard for me to spend time with family and my wife, especially trying to also do the real estate thing. So now we're finally in a position after like 2 years of hustling, straight up hustling, where I can get a little bit more time back to spend with my wife. And we have our firstborn son here due in June. So the timing works out perfectly where I can get a little bit time back to be there for her and be there for him.
Well, congratulations. That's wonderful news. And you're about to embark on a new and very busy journey, I can tell you from experience. So the next 3-4 years are going to be tough, but it's great that you've created the time, you know, ahead of time to give yourself that flexibility. So tell me, so the 32 doors you own, what do they consist of? Is this multifamily? Is this single family? Is it a mixture? You know, what do you own?
Mostly single family. That's my bread and butter. But I've been diving into the small multi-space. Started with the duplex, then went to a quad unit, then went to an 8-unit. And now we're just looking to go bigger and better. So we're looking at another 8-unit building right now and some other like 16-unit, kind of like small mom and pop multi has been kind of a fascinating asset class for me. So I've kind of been really looking into that as like maybe doing one or two big ones a year. But then I do a couple like single family every month just to like keep it going, because we do have a full-time home buying business now. So we have an operating budget, we have a marketing budget. So we do continue like to flip and wholesale along the way and just cherry pick the ones that we want to keep.
So was the first business that you started, was that was wholesaling down, I take it?
Was that so my first business was honestly just buy and hold rentals. We focused on direct to seller marketing. I guess that was our kind of main business model, was direct to seller marketing and utilizing creative finance or BRRRRs to be able to hold on to the property. So first starting off, I didn't offload any of that inventory. I held it, which is why I was probably able to scale my portfolio quicker. Luckily, we did have like a guaranteed paycheck coming in every single month. So I didn't need to live off of that income immediately. That allowed me to just hold the property and start building up the passive income slowly. Cause it's, that's the hardest part, I think, is like, if you're starting off and you don't have a full-time W-2 or another source of income, you got to start flipping and wholesaling to at least get some money back in just for you to survive. But I didn't have that issue. So I 100% held everything that I could.
And were you investing like in your area? Like, where are the assets that you own? Are they concentrated in a single place or are they all over the place?
So, well, they're kind of all over the place now, but I kind of invested wherever the Army sent me. So at first I was investing in Fayetteville, North Carolina. So bought a lot of houses out there. And then right now where I'm stationed is Sioux Falls, South Dakota. So way out here in South Dakota, I don't know anybody. I never heard of Sioux Falls until I got the orders. But now I do buy property here in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. And I think it's a fantastic Midwest market. It's a little bit off the radar, I feel like, compared to maybe your other Midwest markets like Kansas City, St. Louis, Omaha. So I do love Sioux Falls. I kind of look at it as a mini Omaha. And I do invest a lot in Florida as well. That's where my home buying business is established. And so that's probably where the bulk of our transactions lie, is in the Treasure Coast region of Florida.
I actually have one deal in Sioux Falls. So it's a new,
new
construction multifamily deal that I'm a partner in. That is probably about halfway done now. Actually, they might be finishing up pretty soon. But
wow, you have to shoot me the details on that, because I see a lot of new construction popping up. The downtown area has had a lot of just new projects springing up. So I'd be interested to take a look at that, and I could drive by it.
Yeah, it's called Blue on Lorraine. So it's on that little Lake Lorraine, like right in the middle of Sioux Falls. So
I'm familiar.
That's going up. And Sioux Falls is growing like mad. So I think it's a good place to be investing for sure. And so are you planning, when you're out of the military, are you going to go to Florida or are you going to stay in Sioux Falls, or you haven't decided what you're going to do yet?
So I got a couple months left of service and we plan on moving back down to the Treasure Coast region of Florida. So I actually do have a house there already. And we did I coined it as the burp strategy. It's a spinoff of the burr, where we just bought it, renovated it and refinanced it into a primary residence. And so luckily the numbers were pretty good. So we pretty much on the back end got out of it without leaving a down payment in there. So it's a nice house now. It was a turd, I guess, when we bought it, but it's super nice now. It's probably one of the nastier properties we bought, but we'll be moving into down there once we get out here soon.
So let's back up a second and kind of talk about how you actually broke in. I mean, you've kind of given us a good overview of where you are now. But, for someone, you know, who's in a similar situation where you've got a steady job, you have a little bit of savings, you want to break into the field, you know, if you were to say, well, this is the Taylor Wang recipe, this is how I did it, you know, what did you do?
I always say that the recipe that I think really propelled us to see how much explosive growth that we've had is probably utilizing creative finance, because the biggest obstacle for me, I'm a young guy. Again, I don't really come from a lot of money, so we just didn't have capital. Now, for a lot of people I talk to, capital is probably the biggest obstacle. And they say, oh, if I only had money, I could do all these deals. And so I always have to challenge them and say, no, I mean, look at us. We're a prime example. We're proof of concept that you really don't need money to start. If you can master financing and you can use these different strategies as tools, add them to your tool belt and apply them to different situations, you can step into deals with a lot of really cool structures and you don't need a lot of capital. So we did a lot of cool structures where we were able to leverage either a low or no down payment, sub two, assume the mortgages, doing BRRRR strategy, seller financing. So every structure that we were able to place on a property, I negotiated it so it actually works for me. So I didn't have to come in with 20% down every single time I needed to get into a new property.
So like, just use an example, sort of like the first one you did. How did you take that one down?
So my very first one I did was a VA loan house hack. And I bought that just right coming off a deployment, moved into it, fixed it up a little bit, and then put another person into the third bedroom. And then, I mean, it was a really inexpensive house. I bought it for cheap. So the mortgage was like $550. and my rent was 600. So I was just living for free and pocketing a lot of BAH. That kind of helped me springboard into the first burr that I did, which I bought off a courthouse auction. Mm. Had to figure out how to do that, and bought it for, oh, I don't know, like 92K or something like that. And then I put $20,000 into this property and then did a, you know, a refinance. So I burred it and then it appraised for like 200K. So, you know, we actually were able to get all of our money back plus some, cover all the holding and closing costs. And now I still actually own that property. It's a cash flowing rental. So that was my very first deal ever. And at that point, I had never done like a true investment deal before, never managed a rehab, never did a refinance. It was all theoretical. I just kind of knew how a burr worked and I just took it to the streets and applied it to do that first one. So it was a leap of faith. I had to put my whole savings, 30 grand or so, into the down payment with a hard money loan. So I was pretty, like, I guess, anxious about it. But I think our whole process has been a continual cycle of overcoming self-doubts, limitations, and fears to be able to step into new types of deals and new levels of deals. So you can't let yourself hold you back from opportunities.
So talk about that. I mean, so what kind of mental obstacles did you have to overcome in order to do this?
Well, for that first deal, I mean, I was literally putting my entire savings into that deal. And majority of it was in a Roth IRA. And then I just wasn't really too excited about the Roth IRA. I liquidated it and I put it into this deal. So literally what I was making a gamble. I was betting on me. I was like, well, I could either keep on trying to put money in this and then, you know, wait until I'm 59 and a half or however old so I can start withdrawing from it. Or I guess I could have rolled it into self-directed, but I was I just put it in for like, I only had maybe a year's worth of it in there too. So really I wasn't hit too hard with the tax hit. So for me, it made sense to just liquidate. So I took a bet, pulled that, liquidated the whole thing, put it into this first deal. So that was a little bit nerve-wracking for me because I was like, well, I mean, I'm still young, so I can recover if I lose 30 grand, but it also sucks because I spent the last year or so trying to like scrape to save this up. So I didn't want to lose that. But I had faith in myself and the numbers. I thought the numbers looked good. There's no way I lose here. I've done my due diligence. I've looked at the property. I've looked at all the CapEx items. Like, I can't lose here. So at least I hope so. So I just took a bet and I pulled off that first deal. And on the back end, when I pulled out all that capital, had all my money back, plus I had that brand new renovated rental that was cash flowing and I had 25% equity in there, then everything clicked. And I had a lot more faith and a lot more confidence. There's something that we call like the law of the first deal, where we say, if you can pull off your first deal, if we can help you successfully, like find success in that first deal, all of your anxiety, all of your systems that you set up will be tested, will be stress tested when you do that first deal. And if you can pull it off successfully, we don't need to reinvent the wheel every single time. Let's just keep rinse and repeat and do that over and over again. So we just have to create a system that works, that you can pull off that first deal successfully. And that's exactly what we did. After that one, I was all in. And we just took off to the races after that.
And did you keep on looking at foreclosed properties, or, you know, where did you source deals after that first one?
Yeah. So after that, we looked at the courthouse auction still. We're still looking at that. But we started also really diving into direct to seller marketing. So starting off, I was probably doing like the most basic thing. I was walking my dog and looking at houses in the neighborhoods and writing addresses down on a piece of paper. And then I would go out. If they were home, I would door knock. And if it was vacant, I would just skip trace and I would call those numbers off of a Google Voice. So I didn't have a marketing budget at this point. It was just straight up hustle. Calling those numbers one by one. And I would crush some deals by just doing that. Very basic, nothing crazy, not spending a lot in marketing, or actually really spending nothing besides the cost of the skip trace. And I closed like a handful of deals just by doing that. And so
are you just calling them up and making them an offer like on the spot, saying, hey, I'll pay you this much for your home? Or what was that like? And also, I also wanted to ask you, were you looking for specific things, like homes that were a little run down, or like No. Sorry, you can answer the question. I'll have to get that.
Yeah.
Out. I'm sorry. Were you looking for specific types of properties when you were out there walking your dog? And then once, so what were they? And then once you found them, you know, when you were calling those owners, what were you saying to them?
Yeah. So we were looking for very specific things here. What we were looking for was just signs of distress. So if there was any indication of the property where it looked like it might have had any indication of distress, I would write that address down. Now, that looks like many different things. For one, it could just be a little rundown looking. Maybe, you know, a landlord's owned it for a long time. And, you know, over time, the properties, you know, tenants don't take care of properties as much as homeowners. So maybe it just looks a little rundown. Now, if the yard's overgrown, if the windows are boarded up or broken, if there's signs from the city on the house, then I know like that's a motivated lead right there. Or if I just noticed there was nobody living there at all, if it was vacant, another great sign. So I would write down any properties that look like they just needed general TLC, and I would go ahead and call or door knock those ones. Now, when I called, I think this is what separates me the most from my competitors is we're not super salesy and we're not coming out of the gate with the standard script that a lot of people probably use. We really focus on relationship marketing and selling yourself. So when I would call these homeowners or whoever has the property, we would more just like introduce ourselves. You know, I'd say something like, you know, my name's Taylor. You know, I was just walking by your property on this street. I'm your neighbor, actually. We live in the community and I care a lot about this community, actually. We're pretty involved. So just wanted to, you know what's kind of going on with the property. You know, we do buy a couple houses here and there. We're just a mom and pop type of business, just looking for a couple houses maybe to just kind of get some passive income, help, you know, help my family out, support my wife and, you know, just get by. I'm an Army guy here. So, you know, we're just local members of your community. And we would get a lot of positive feedback from that because we weren't coming out the gate, I don't think, saying, you know, you want an offer? Like, and if they weren't interested, it's fine. I didn't take offense to that. We would just have a good conversation and, you know, I'd let them know to, you know, think about me if they thought about selling in the future. So not salesy at all, not pushy. We're more looking at trying to build a relationship. And I would kind of ask them more about them, the story behind the house, like, you know, why was it vacant or why did it look like that? And if they were receptive, then I would explain to them how we can create a win-win-win solution where, you know, potentially I can give them an offer and they can win by getting rid of this property. That's probably kind of a problem for them. If it looks like that, if it's in that kind of condition, it's probably just a problem. So I would give them a solution to that problem. That's the main thing is we solve problems. Now, I'd also tell them our community is going to win because, again, I live in this neighborhood and that property is kind of an eyesore. Like we would love it to like fix that house up, move in a nice, maybe another military family and raise the property values across the neighborhood. So the community is going to benefit. You're going to benefit. And of course, I mean, I'm going to benefit since I'm buying it too. And I'm expecting to make some money off it, which is why I'm buying it. So let's create a win-win-win solution for everybody.
That sounds very effective, actually. It sounds, you know, if you're going for the relationship, then, you know, you kind of win no matter what, right? I mean, if you don't get the deal, you still create the relationship and probably somebody's going to go and say, hey, this guy called me, but he was really nice. Like not like those other kind of smarmy folks who call and try to buy my house. Right. So, that's great. You know, what happened then? I assume he's by doing that, you started getting some momentum, started getting some deals under your belt, kind of building the portfolio. And so you mentioned that you have like now a full-time home buying business in Florida. Like describe that and how that came to be and what that looks like.
Yeah. And this is a little bit of a newer venture. I started this company after I had all these rentals and I kind of knew the formula. I know how to run acquisitions. But now my focus has been, how do we put this into a business? Because I was kind of running it as more of a side hustle, like solopreneur kind of thing. So now I was like, let's create systems. let's put teams and systems in place where we can make this a process. So then we created our company. And so now we do, you know, we spend money on operations and on marketing, and it's more like systematized so that I'm not, you know, the one hustling like in the trenches all the time trying to do all the jobs. So now my tasks mainly focus on what I enjoy most, which is just talking to motivated homeowners. That's what all I focus on. And we just had to really take a step back and look at what is our most income producing activity. And then let's focus on that. Everything else, let's put a process, automate, or outsource. So everything else is outsourced or automated. So, you know, CRMs with, you know, automatic follow-ups or automatic messages, virtual assistants that do a lot of lead prospecting, websites that drive traffic to us. So now we have a full-fledged home buying business.
And are you still, how are you sourcing deals now? I mean, are you still, you know, walking the streets, or you have some other kind of process involved in like finding potential acquisition targets?
Yeah. So I'm not local in our area yet, so I'm not able to knock doors, but we still do. We'll like have our guys drive around the neighborhood. When we get a new acquisition, we'll drive the neighborhoods and see if there's any other properties in the neighborhood that also might be receptive to an offer. But I would say majority are coming from the digital space. Mm. So website traffic, your PPC type of traffic or Facebook ads. A lot of our traffic is driven from the digital market space now, but we still do a lot of other different things. We'll try different campaigns with postcards and text call, all that fun stuff. But I still, my favorite is always just the direct, you know, person to person type of closing. So if I can get down there and knock on a couple doors or figure out a way where we can make another process around doing business face-to-face, it's still always going to be my favorite.
And what kind of stuff do you target? Like, what's the price range? And, you know, like, do you have kind of like a ABC, you know, class you're looking at? What do you like to buy?
It's for that, it's mainly single family. So, you know, single family value add plays. So in our market, we're probably looking at anywhere between 200 to maybe 300K type of properties. Those are our favorites. I mean, eventually we might go up into some larger, more like luxury, bigger type of houses. And our market does have a lot of like luxury waterfront type of real estate. So those would be really fun projects, but it's a little bit of a different space than what we're used to. So we kind of stick to more of the bread and butter, like your, I don't know, typical starter house or type of family house that's more affordable. Because what we notice is the hold times are quicker. People, there's a bigger population that can buy those type of properties. So if we're flipping or wholesaling, or they might be good rentals. So there's just more buyers for those types. So we kind of stick to that a little more. So 200 to 300K value add plays and single family houses. Now, for my personal acquisition, though, I always do hunt for some bigger deals. And so one thing that we were looking at doing this year is doing a boutique hotel. So we are looking out for a hotel here. We put an offer on one earlier this year, but it didn't land. But we're learning, you know, and that's kind of our next step. But we would just like to do bigger and bigger deals as we scale.
And so, I mean, I actually have done one boutique hotel, and I'm looking at a second one now. Are you looking? I'm curious, what kind of hotel were you looking at?
Yep. So this one was a waterfront one down there in our market in Florida, and it was distressed. I mean, it needed a lot of work. So it was probably going to be around a $5 million purchase price with a $2 million rehab budget. And we would have syndicated this, and basically it would have been like a one year whole like renovation on the front end. And then we probably would start paying profits after that once we can actually lease up the units. But it was 25 units there waterfront. It would have been a beautiful building. And it would have been an exciting project. But we got to the 5-yard line in negotiations and just couldn't get it done. So but we're still hunting wherever we can do the next one. And I'd definitely sometime need to talk to you about yours as well. It sounds like a interesting project, and I'd love to kind of pick your brain on it.
Sure. I'm happy to talk about it offline if you like. But the Are you looking to operate this as a hotel or as an Airbnb, or, you know, what was your strategy here? I mean, the one that we have, we're just running it as a straight hotel, even though originally I thought, oh, I'd Airbnb this out, but it just, when I looked at it, it made more sense to do it as a hotel just to rehab it. But what were you thinking about for this play and sort of future plays?
Yep, mainly Airbnb, but we have a lot of interest in setting up a direct booking site as well. Mm-hmm. So we would have advertised this on Airbnb, Vrbo, and our direct booking site.
Got it. So you wouldn't, you'd be just be running it as like a serial Airbnb essentially, rather than as a hotel per se.
Exactly. Yeah.
So you also mentioned that you're doing software, I believe. So tell me about that.
Yes, sir. So I jumped on with a team of guys over at townsquare.com. It's a tech startup. So of course it's just TWNSQR.com. So they drop all the vowels because we're hip and techie, but so townsquare.com. And what we're trying to do is revolutionize the way that wholesalers are doing dispositions. And we're trying to revolutionize the off-market market space. Because as it stands now, if you're interested in buying off-market real estate, you just have to know somebody. You have to be just plugged into some different wholesalers. There is not truly a singular marketplace where anybody can go to and just browse all of the off-market inventory. So I'll think of it almost like a Zillow of off-market. Our little catchphrase is, we're bringing the off-market online, right? So that's what we're trying to do here. Now, a lot of really exciting updates here, but what we're doing is we're onboarding a lot of new buyers and a lot of new wholesalers to this marketplace. Because the hardest thing about developing a marketplace, what we've come to find out, is it's like the argument of what came first, the chicken or the egg. It's like, we need the deals, but we also need the buyers. And who's going to come on first? They kind of both have to come on together in order for a marketplace to work. So a marketplace, we found out, is kind of a hard structure to put together. But now we're getting a lot of momentum. Now we're seeing a lot of exciting things happen. Big time wholesalers are coming on board. We have a lot of buyers lists being uploaded here, organic buyers coming on the platform. So I anticipate this year will be a big year for Town Square. And if anybody that's listening is interested in either buying off market real estate, or you're a wholesaler and you need a platform to use some disposition tools to help you offload your inventory, maybe add new buyers to your buyers list, get deals done faster, definitely come and check us out and see what we can do to help you.
And is that focused in a particular area, or is that pretty much nationwide, sort of wherever you are, you can use the platform?
Yep, we are nationwide. So we just provide the platform for anybody across the entire nation to upload inventory or submit offers on it. So you could be a guy in California and get all of your, you know, purchase all your inventory in Florida. So it makes it convenient, especially if you are buying real estate out of state. So we're pretty excited. Yeah, it's a really cool platform. And yeah, I've even used it to buy a couple myself, actually.
That's awesome. And when did you start that? How long ago?
So our main guy, Paul Wakeham, he's been on this journey for a while. And I came on last year with him, and we launched the official platform in like spring of 2022. We waited about a year and we gathered all the feedback, everything that came back from our clients, people that were using the platform. And we did a relaunch here in February, so last month, and added all the features that everybody wanted. So now it's getting a lot more traction with our relaunch and a lot more excitement. We got some influencers that are pushing out the platform as well. So we're just spreading the word. And we want people to start adopting this.
It sounds very exciting. So, I mean, you're, I guess about 26, 27, something like that at this point.
Yeah. Yes,
so
sir.
It's great you got started so early. I mean, you know, time is really your friend in these things, and the earlier you start, the better. But, you know, where do you see this going in, say, like, you know, 10 years or so? What's your vision for the future?
Yeah, man, my future is going to be interesting, because I feel like with the Army, everything was so planned, just so regimented. And you know exactly where your career is going. It's just a very straightforward path. Like from now, I could just career project and I would know exactly where I would be in 10 years or so. Since I've gone down this journey, I would have never predicted to be sitting in this seat where I'm at now, because I just started investing just a couple of years ago. I would have never considered myself to be sitting in this seat just a couple of years ago. So I don't want to almost undershoot what we're capable of in the next couple of years, because I think we can do some really exciting things. Just if we're at where we're sitting at now, the hardest part is starting and getting that foundation under you. So now that we have that, we have the systems, we have a team, what can we accomplish next? So I've been thinking about that a lot, but the way I see it is I would like to scale our home buying business up. Instead of just doing a couple of deals a month, I'd love to do maybe 5, 6, maybe 10 deals a month. That would be awesome. I would like to see my legacy launch, my mentorship program, also maybe scale into a community where, you know, everybody is collaborating, doing deals together. You know, maybe we can do some in-person events. I love just sharing that knowledge, sharing that wealth, building a community of people, like-minded investors that are all looking to build passive income and financial freedom. That's what really gets me motivated. And as far as Town Square, I'd love to see that scale and grow and maybe do an exit in a couple of years or so and sell the platform for a couple hundred million or something like that. So, you know, I don't know. Like, well, there's so much is unwritten, and I'm just excited to kind of write my story. I feel like everything up till now has been the prelude. And now we're going to write chapter one here soon once we get out of the military.
Well, speaking of which, you know, so before we go, there is one question I'm curious about. You know, what is there anything that you have learned in the military that you find is helping you now in this business?
Absolutely. And I think that comes down to my principles on how I run my business, how I run my life. It all comes down to, I think, the foundation of just the values that are ingrained in me, just not only from the military, but just my upbringing as well. But the military especially, I mean, highly disciplined. You know, we have a very regimented life. So for me, my life is still very regimented. You know, I got a workout in this morning. All morning I'm hitting these calls. I time block my schedule so that every hour is still optimized and we're still accomplishing a lot of things. So I think just that consistency, that discipline, that resilience that I've learned in the military. And then lastly is just, you know, a no surrender attitude. We've had a lot of setbacks, a lot of hard times too. That's just part of being an entrepreneur. You know, it's not as consistent as having a guaranteed paycheck and showing up to your 9 to 5. You have to kind of fight for what you want, and you've got to grow, and you're going to be uncomfortable. So just a no surrender attitude. I'm never going to give up. We're always going to keep growing, and we're going to find a way. So, yeah.
Well, that's a great note to end on. If people want to get in touch with you and learn more about, you know, all these things that you're doing, what's the best way for them to get in touch?
Yeah, they can. I'm most active on Instagram. It's just my name, TaylorWing_. That's the platform I'm most active on, but we're trying to expand our content too. So we're on TikTok and starting to get on YouTube and stuff. And we have a website for Town Square. We have a website for my home buying business. So there's a couple different ways you can find me there. Websites.
What are those websites when you give them?
Townsquare.com. So TWNSQR.com. And our website, if you just Google Black Knight Property Solutions in Florida, will pop up there, and our URL is long. It's like we buy houses for St. Lucie, Florida, or something like that. So yeah, check it out. I would love to meet anybody listening to this and hopefully provide value. Maybe one day we can do a deal together and do some hotels.
Awesome. Well, please everybody make sure to go check out Taylor on Instagram and all those other places that he mentioned. And Taylor, it was great talking with you today. Thanks for your time.
Likewise, Jonathan. Thanks so much for having me.